We have seen that the shortest path problem is actually a transshipment problem. Therefore, it can be solved using the simplex algorithm. But it's not necessarily a good idea because the shortest path problem has some specific properties that can be exploited to get a more efficient algorithm. In this video, we will investigate these properties. When we look at a map, we may have some sort of intuition about what the shortest path could be. But this does not work in the general case. Well, first, the computer does not have this bird's eye view on the network. And second, the triangle inequality may not hold, especially when the coordinates of the nodes have no meaning. In this example, there are 20 paths from node 1 to node 16. In this case, we can identify the shortest one by explicit enumeration. We can enumerate all the paths and find the shortest of them. Here it is. So in this case, the shortest path goes along this way. And it's definitely not something we can guess by intuition. For a computer, the network is like a labyrinth. And in order to figure out its way through this labyrinth, it will write some information at each node, at each intersection of this labyrinth. The idea is to record the distance that has been down along various paths and to write them down. A value will be associated with each node in the network. These values will be called labels. Actually, these values, the labels, happen to be the dual variables associated with the flow conservation constraints of the transshipment problem. In the general context of the transshipment problem, we identified the complementarity slackness conditions to be sufficient and necessary for optimality. These conditions say that for all arcs in the network, this inequality must be verified. And for all arcs carrying some flow, it must be verified as an equality. In the context of the shortest path problem, an arc carrying a flow is an arc that belongs to the shortest path. And therefore, we can translate these complementarity slackness conditions directly as optimality conditions for the shortest path problem. So consider a network with n arcs and m nodes, a cost vector C with a cost for each arc, a vector of labels, lambda, where there is a label for each node, and a path P between node O and node D. If the following conditions are verified, so if lambda j is less or equal to lambda I plus Cij, for each arc in the network, and if this is verified as an equality for each arc in the path P, then P is the shortest path from the origin O to the destination D. I say a shortest path because it may be the case that there are several shortest paths, but at least this one is one of them. Let's prove this result. So let's write down the two conditions. This inequality should be verified for each arc in the network, and it should be verified as an equality for each arc belonging to the path P. Now let's consider a path Q, any path Q between O and D, between the origin and the destination. Q will start from O, then we'll go to node J1, then to node J2, and then it will follow a various list of nodes to node JL, and then to the destination. It doesn't matter how many nodes will be in the path, but it's, let's call it L. Let's calculate now the cost of this path, which is the sum of the cost of the arcs. This is COJ1 plus CJ1 J2 plus CJLD. Now we use the first inequality here that says that the cost of any arc in the network is greater or equal to lambda j minus lambda I. So this will be greater or equal to lambda j1 minus lambda o plus lambda j2 minus lambda j1 plus all the way to lambda d minus lambda jl. And actually, if you look carefully at this sum, you will see that for each intermediary node, j1 to jl, it appears once with a plus and once with a minus. So it will cancel out. So all the nodes which are intermediary, the labels will cancel out. And therefore, this is lambda d minus lambda o. So this is a lower bound on the cost of q. Let's consider p now. And p goes through various nodes. Let's call them i1, i2, ik, let's say, to d. And let's calculate the cost of p. Again, the cost of the pass is the sum of the cost of each arc. So we have the arc o, i1, plus i1, i2, plus, and so on, c, I, k, d. Now we exploit the second condition here that says that for each arc in P, we have the equality. So we can replace the cost by the difference of the labels with equality here. So this is lambda I1 minus lambda O plus lambda I2 minus lambda I1 plus all the way to lambda D minus lambda IK. And as before, we can see that for each intermediary node, I1 to IK, the lambdas will cancel out. And therefore, what we have is lambda d minus lambda o. And we have seen here that lambda d minus lambda o is less or equal to CQ. So we can write less or equal to CQ. And this proves the result. Indeed, Q is any arbitrary path between O and D. And we have shown that the cost of Q is greater or equal to the cost of P. Therefore, P has the minimal cost. It is the shortest path between O and D. And that proves the result. Let's consider the example that we presented before. So here, next to each arc, you find the cost. And inside each node, you have the label, lambda. In this picture, you can see that the condition is verified with equality on the plane arcs. For example, here we have lambda I equals 1, lambda j equals 2, cij equals 1. So 1 is equal to 2 minus 1. We can verify it here as well. We have lambda I equals 4, lambda j equals 12. Cij equals 8. So we have that 8 is equal to 12 minus 4. When you look at the dotted arcs, the inequality condition is verified. If we take this example, we have lambda I equals 14, lambda j equals 10, and Cij equals 8. So it is true that lambda j is less or equal to lambda I plus Cij. So lambda I plus Cij is 22, which is larger than lambda j. Actually, if you look at the subnetwork that is composed of the plane arcs, you get a tree. It's actually a spanning tree. And because the plane arcs verify the condition with equality, they belong to a shortest path. So what this tree is representing is the set of all shortest paths from the origin here to any node. For example, if we want to look at the shortest path between 0 and 14, this goes this way, this way, this way, this way, this way, this way, and this way. Because we have a tree, there is only one path between two nodes. And in this case, because all the arcs of this path verify the condition with equality, it means that it is the shortest path. Similarly, you can calculate the shortest path between 0 and 8. This is this path. And if you want to go to this node, you need to follow the path all the way here. So this is called the shortest path tree. This is a spanning tree of the network such that each path in the tree is the shortest path. As we discussed already for the transshipment problem, the optimality conditions for the shortest path problem involve the labels only as a difference. So only the differences of the labels matter. Therefore, it's common practice to normalize one of them. And typically, we normalize lambda O, so the value of the label at the origin, to zero. The reason is that we will interpret the labels later on as a distance traveled within the network. It is like a counter. And the idea of this normalization is that we initialize the counter to zero at the origin. The shortest path problem is not always well defined. In particular, if there exists a path between O and D that contains a cycle with negative cost, then there is no forward path that is the shortest path. So this is an example where I have a cycle of cost minus 2 in a path between O and D. So it means that if you give me any path from O and D and you pretend it's the shortest, I will always be able to find a shorter one by making as many tours around this cycle as needed. The problem in this case is not bounded and there is no shortest path. We now assume that the network does not contain any cycle with negative cost. So if there is a cycle, it has a non-negative cost. And I claim that we can always find a shortest path, which is a simple path, meaning that does not contain a cycle. Let's take an example of a path that contains a cycle. We can start from the origin, then go to node 1, then go to node 2, then back to node 1, node 2, and then to D. The length of this path is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now if we remove the cycle, if we take a path Q, where we remove the cycle here. So the cycle from 2 to 2 is removed. So we have 0, 1, 2, and D. Well, here the cost of Q is 3. And actually, this property is always true. The cost of Q will always be less or equal to the cost of P because we have removed the cycle. And we have assumed that there is no cycle with negative cost. Therefore, the cycle has a non-negative cost. Removing it will decrease the cost of the path. And then we can do this each time we find a cycle in a path until there is no cycle anymore. And then we will obtain a simple path, which will have a smaller cost. So if the conclusion is that if there is a shortest path, there is a shortest path that is a simple path. We can also calculate lower bounds on the length of the shortest path. Well, if the vector of cost is non-negative, well, this is trivial. The cost of the shortest path will be non-negative. Otherwise, if the network contains some arc with negative cost, but no cycle with negative cost, then we can easily show that the cost of P is bounded by M minus 1 times the minimum over all arc of the cost. The idea is simple. A simple path in the network can have maximum m minus 1 arcs because m is the number of nodes. So this is the maximum number of arcs that can be in a simple path. And the smallest possible cost on each of these arcs is actually the smallest cost appearing in the network. So there is no way to go below this value, and we have a lower bound. This lower bound will happen to be useful in the algorithm so that we can detect if indeed the network has a negative cost cycle or not. Another nice property of shortest path problems is called the principle of optimality. So let's consider this path, which is starting from the origin to the destination, along various nodes. And the principle of optimality says that if you take any node like L here, if the path P is a shortest path between O and D, then the subpath OL is a shortest path between O and L. Similarly, the subpath LD is a shortest path from L to D. This is called the principle of optimality. In this video, we have reviewed some properties of the shortest path problems. We have seen the optimality conditions based on the labels. We have seen that if a path contains a cycle with negative costs, there is no shortest path. And we have derived a lower bound on the length of the shortest path. And finally, we have introduced the principle of optimality that says that the subpaths of a shortest path are also optimal.